Take one. Stand by. Quiet in the studio.
I'm the chief.
Shut off the dishwasher.
Well, the elevator key still works. As you can tell, we're on the fourth floor of Marillac Hall, and behind me, the TV center, which is where tonight's story begins. But first, a few adjustments. Alexa, lighting, 1970s.
Television, lighting, circa 1970, dull.
To begin, let's take a little walk. September 1970, the new freshman class, slated to graduate 1974. Among them, Pat Cronin, enrolled in the Communication Arts program. He attends classes, studies hard. Soon he learns of other students going one step further. And their thought was,
why don't we do our own shows? And instead of just doing the St. John's University Roundtable, we'd like to do some things. We'd like to stretch ourselves creatively, and we formed the TV club.
So, Pat, what kind of equipment was available to the students of the 1970s?
You're looking at master control for the TV center, which is located on the fourth floor of Marillac Hall. What you see is just a small part of the tremendous assortment of equipment required to put a TV show on the air. Things are relatively quiet here now, but in just a few moments, TV Club members will be arriving to transform this studio into the production center for the show on which this report will be seen. Although the club is composed primarily of members who had never seen the inside of a TV studio before their arrival at St. John's, it has come to be regarded as one of the most professional organizations on campus.
From New York, The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Bamberger, Ahmed Suarez, along with Doc Natalie and the ITV Orchestra.
The Golden Days of Radio.
Yes, the name of our game is Bumps!
And there was Pat, right in the middle of all these productions. And in fact, he's on camera for this number.
Go and get Beanie, the coconut tree. Let a coconut fall on your head. You can have a dream the same as me.
From camera operation, editing, refurbishing Mobile Mabel, and occasionally an on-camera appearance, Pat was truly involved. But soon, 4 years are in the mirror, and it's time to begin your career.
CBS presents this program in color.
October 1974. Pat is hired by CBS, and one of his first jobs is a single-camera shoot, the CBS Morning News with Hughes Rudd. But soon, he moves to daytime soap operas.
This is Search for Tomorrow. This portion.
1979, Pat jumps from the network to local WCBS, working for Channel 2 News.
This is Channel 2 News at 6.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jim Jensen.
And I'm Michelle Marsh.
He covers the gamut. Politics, crime, fires, you name it. He is also present for the technical advances which take electronic news gathering to the next level.
When your job involves setting up equipment in a live shot in the midst of total chaos, or when you're scrambling to cover a breaking news story, or even if you've just been having a hard day and you could use somebody with the driest yet silliest sense of humor in that car with you, I always knew I was blessed to have Pat as my partner at WCBS. He was the smartest, funniest, kindest man I've ever known, and I miss him.
In 1984, Pat wins a National Emmy for his edited package on the Republican Convention in Dallas. Pat is briefly upgraded to supervisor, but it's not his cup of tea. Pat returns to field work. And once again, we are joined at the hip covering all of the top stories, some very weird, but always entertaining.
When I was covering Long Island in the late 1980s, I was supposedly the reporter and Pat Cronin was supposedly the photographer, but that's not exactly how it worked out, because Pat knew Long Island like the back of his hand, and he knew who the opinion leaders were. He knew who was on which side of which issue, where to find them, what they were going to say, and who we needed to put in what story to make everything accurate, fair, balanced, and ahead of the competition. It was like having another reporter, a much more seasoned reporter, in the van with me. We consistently finished ahead of the competition, and one of those reasons was I had Pat Cronin next to me. It was literally invaluable. He was first and foremost a journalist, and one I was really proud to work alongside.
CBS Studio 53, currently the home of The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. It is also named the Ed Sullivan Theater after this man.
The Beatles! Oh,
yeah. Ed Sullivan brought entertainment and big ratings to CBS from 1948 to 1971. In 1998, CBS had their corporate eye on late night. And to compete with The Tonight Show, they negotiated with David Letterman. But it wasn't going well. Someone had the idea to offer Letterman CBS Studio 53 and assigned Pat to photograph it, to be part of the next dialogue. And it was after seeing Pat's video that Letterman decided to sign with CBS.
Greatest city in the world, it's The Late Show.
Well, that and the fact that he was getting a salary of $16 million might have had something to do with it. Pat and I ended our work partnership in 1996. Pat continued the Long Island Bureau with reporter Jennifer McLogan until his retirement from CBS in 2017. A very long and productive career. To close tonight's presentation, some advice from the honoree.
If you're interested in any of these projects, just drop by the TV Center located on the fourth floor of Marillac Hall at any time. Considering the power of the television medium, you can't afford not to become involved. Pat Cronin, TVC News, at the TV Center. That ought to hold the little bastards.